Okay, 402, let's get going here. Welcome everyone to this MICDE seminar. I'm Eric Michielssen, I'm a faculty member in electrical engineering and computer science, a faculty member in the radiation labs to be specifically. And it's my distinct pleasure today to introduce Dr. Yang Liu. Yang and I, we go back a long, long way. Yang was my PhD student here at the University of Michigan, graduated in 2015. With a fantastic thesis that made significant breakthroughs in the construction of parallel and fast time domain integral equation solvers. Yang was the first one to construct a provably parallel time domain integral equation solver for electromagnetics. Then Yang stayed on and as a postdoc, he kind of turned his attention away from his PhD topic, and he started working on these so-called butterfly methods, which are really the topic of his talk today, so I won't dwell on them. But these butterfly methods have proven instrumental in computational electromagnetics in the construction of, for example, fast direct solvers and the like. And Yang, for these efforts in 2018, won the IEEE Antenna Propagation Shelkunov Award. That's really the best paper award for all the papers published in the IEEE Transactions on Antennas and Propagation that year. Yang has applied butterfly methods and developed butterfly methods for many applications well outside computational electromagnetics. And that really is the focus now of his work as a research scientist at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. So I think without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Yang here. Yang, yeah, tell us all about butterfly methods.
All right. So thanks, Eric, for the nice introduction. It's my great pleasure to come back to University of Michigan after a few years and to talk about something I started with Eric. I do see a few familiar names in the list, so pretty happy. So nowadays, if you attend the conferences, many of the organizers will ask you to record the presentation for better quality. I assume that's also acceptable here, and that's what I did. So I will start the presentation, and feel free to leave any comments or questions in the chat window. I'll be happy to answer it in the same time. Okay, so let's start. Today, I will give a brief overview of fast direct solvers. Direct solvers are factorization-based linear solvers, which are widely used in many scientific and engineering domains. It appears in the context of boundary elements methods, but later was extended to many other numerical formulations and applications. So today, I will mainly focus on their development in terms of wave equation and their applications in all frequency regions. This is a joint work with many of my collaborators, including my colleagues at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab and UC Berkeley, and my previous colleagues at the University of Michigan, including Eric, and other collaborators at NTU and Purdue University. First, I will give a brief overview of linear solvers, both dense and sparse, iterative and direct solvers. Then I will talk about fast direct solver for integral equation or boundary element method formulations. I will talk about low rank based solvers for low frequency problems and the butterfly based solvers for high frequency problems and give some electromagnetic applications. Then I will switch my topic to fast direct solvers for differential equations. For example, finite element or finite difference based formulations. I will talk about the multifrontal sparse solver with nested dissection. Then I'll move to a low rank based and a butterfly based fast direct solvers. And I will talk both electromagnetic and acoustic applications. Many computational electromagnetic problems boil down to solving a linear system AX equals to B. They can appear in scattering and radiation analysis, cavity design, inverse problems, biomedical engineering applications. So they can either appear as standalone solvers. For example, if we have a frequency domain finite difference of an element discretization, which is mostly used for heterogeneous media, or we have the frequency domain integral equation formulation, which is mostly used for homogeneous or piecewise constant media, we can end up solving either dense or linear systems. And in addition, these FEM solvers, their time domain counterpart also requires solving a linear system sometimes. These linear solvers can also appear as sub-solvers inside of more higher level solvers. For example, it can appear as the sub-solvers in domain decomposition-based solvers, multi-grid solvers, multi-physics solvers, and even for eigen solvers. Here, I will give you two examples of linear systems. The first one is using integral equations for solving 3D scattering from perfectly electric conducting surfaces. Assuming we have an electric field EI impinging on this surface, it will generate a current J on the surface, and which in turn generates an electric scattered electric field ES. By enforcing that the total electric field on the surface must vanish, we come up with this very well-known electric field integral equation, or EFIE. And after discretizing the surface current J using n local basis functions and doing a Galerkin testing of the EFIE, we end up with this dense n by n linear system, where each entry of the matrix represents pairwise Green function interaction. So the Green function is also shown here. The second example is the finite element method for 3D scattering involving an inhomogeneous scatter volume V here. Here where it turns out to discretize the vector Helmholtz equation. Then it results into this sparse n-by-n linear system. So these are actually two examples of linear systems in computational electromagnetics.
There are three well-known methodologies for solving linear systems, namely iterative solvers, direct solvers, and preconditional iterative solvers. For iterative solvers, for example, the Krylov method, we typically just apply the system A to trial vectors until the iteration converges. The metavec is usually has a lower complexity and it's easy to parallelize, but the iteration may not converge if it's your conditional system. For the direct solvers, A is modified into a new or factorized into a new form. It's usually more numerically robust, but it's hard to optimize or parallelize. And it's also higher complexity compared to metavec. The third option, the preconditioned iterative solver, combines the direct solver and the iterative solver, and that usually represents some trade-offs between the convergence and the solver complexity. So there are quite a few available, even open source direct solvers out there for both the sparse and dense linear systems, and on both sequential shared memory and distributed memory machines. Here, I just listed a few of them here. For wave equations, here I listed a summary of the complexities of the state-of-art linear solvers. For exact solvers, let Ni denote the iteration count. For dense and sparse systems, iterative solvers will require N squared and N cost for single matrix vector multiplication. For direct solvers, it requires n cubed and n squared for dense and sparse linear systems for the LU or the system factorization. For low frequency regime, fast solvers can attain linear complexities for each of the combination here. And for high frequency regime, fast solvers can also attain almost quasi-linear complexities for each of the type here. And these solvers are fast really because of the use or the development of the fast algorithm, either analytic or algebraic. Here we'll just focus on those fast algorithms for direct solvers. Let's first look at dense systems. Recall this dense EFIE system. A typical workflow for fast direct solver is first do some clustering of the geometry so that you can reorder the matrix rows and entries to better compress blocks of the Z matrix. So once you compress the Z matrix, we can factorize or invert Z explicitly, also in a compressed form. And then finally, we can apply the inverse to any right-hand side. Here is an example of the geometric clustering using a simple KD tree algorithm. So consider this surface, and we first try to find a cut that split this curve into two pieces. And for each of two pieces, we further find a cut that keeps splitting until we reaches the segments which have the prescribed sizes. For example, this example shows the eight leaf segments. And according to this partitioning, we can reorder the matrix such that for blocks of the matrix that representing well-separated or non-overlapping interactions between two local clusters or local partitions, we can utilize algebraic compression tools. In terms of the algebraic compression tool, let's first talk about the so-called low-rank compression-based direct solvers. Depending on how much portion of the blocks are compressed, and depending on whether these blocks' compression are dependent, we have can have several categories of the low-rank compression formats. For example, the H matrix, H2 matrix, HODR matrix, or HSS matrix. There's even some non-hierarchical format called the BRR matrix. Let's then now talk about how to compress, how to construct this low-rank format. Suppose we want to get a low-rank representation of a block here. There are essentially two ways of construction. The first one is assuming any matrix entry can be computed in a fast way. Then you essentially only need to compute the submatrices of the entire block for fast construction. So here I listed a few fast algorithms, for example, CUR, skeletonization, ACA, or blocked ACA. The second option is if you can apply this block fast to any vectors, then you can also construct this low rank product in quadrilinear complexity using randomized low rank compression algorithm. Let's now take a closer look at a few hierarchical low rank direct solvers. The first one is the H matrix. So now the left figure, or let's assume the green and the red blocks are already compressed by low rank algorithms. We just mentioned the previous slide. In the direct solver, we perform LU factorization on this compressed form, the lower their lower left shows the higher level description of the so-called the partition of block block partition LU factorization, and we can see during the LU factorization we have to perform this low rank operations in a fast fashion. And we'll keep the result also as a low-rank product. We can now make the compression more aggressive by compressing more blocks than the H matrix. This is the HODR format. We will factorize the HODR matrix as a product of log n factors. Each of them have the orange blocks represented as a low-rank product. And each of them can be inverted quickly by the so-called Shirley-Morrison-Woodbury formula. we can be even more aggressive by going from HODLR to HSS format, where instead of keeping the column, the row basis of the Lorentz product of each block independent, we can use the row and column basis at its corresponding children blocks to represent its basis. For example, we can use this U3 and U4 times a small transfer matrix to represent the basis U1. And once we have this HSS format, we can factorize it quickly by, for example, the ULV type of factorization or telescope type of inversion technique. So far, we have reviewed three Lorentz direct solvers. There are many other alternatives studied by many experts in the mass community, in electromagnetic community, and many other engineering domains. The overall idea is to represent the off-diagonal blocks with low-rank products and factorize the matrix in a compressed form using fast algebras. In practice, which one is best really depends on the dimension of the problem, the shape of the geometry, and the particular frequency of interest. For example, in this table, I showed when we move from the H matrix to HODLR, then to HSS, we essentially have smaller and smaller leading constant. But since we're becoming more and more aggressive, it's typically will have larger and larger ranks. But the overall remark I want to highlight is that quasi-linear complexity can be obtained for low frequency regime. By low frequency, I mean the computational domain spans at most a few wavelengths. But for high frequency regimes, low rank direct solvers becomes less efficient, really because that the rank here depends on the particular frequency. Let's take a look at the rank behavior for blocks in H matrix. Consider this block representing a green function interaction between two separated 2D curves. It's well known the interaction rank scales as the wave number times the diameter of the observer curve and the diameter of the south curve divided by the distance of the two. There's also a similar formula for 3D problems. So in our scaling test, we will increase the frequency and increasing the block size accordingly. So the left, the lower left figure is the rank calculated by ACA between two coplanar square. The rank is proportional to the wave number. The lower left is the rank between two cubes, and the rank behaves like wave number square. Therefore, for high frequency regime, low rank direct solvers are actually slow. Instead, we need to consider alternative algebraic representation, for example, the butterfly algorithm. The butterfly algorithm was originally proposed by Michielssen and Bogue in 1996. It essentially says, instead of considering the interaction between the entire geometry pair, we can consider the interaction between sub-geometry pairs in a multi-level fashion. For example, consider this level zero here. So here we consider like entire observer versus small sources. The size of the sources are chosen as 1 over k, such that the rank formula will behave as a constant. In the next level, we'll split the observer into two and merge every sources into one, and shown in blue here. And when we look at the rank formula, it's again a constant. So this can keep going until the very last level, where we have small observers and large sources. And in the algebraic form, it really says the submatrices showing in below here all have small or constant ranks. And we can call this rank the butterfly rank. The algebraic form of a butterfly is shown below here. So it can be shown, it's actually constructed by low rank decomposition of all the submatrices above in a nested fashion. For example, any of the submatrices, for example, the red submatrix above is actually the product of the red blocks below. There are many equivalent forms of butterflies, but in this talk, we will focus on this particular form shown here. The way to construct the butterfly representation, we also have two options. The first is that we know how to compute any entry fast. The second is we know how to apply the block fast to any vectors. So let's take a look at the first one. So we start from level one, and we form a low rank product of this highlighted blue block in B. And we will keep the red factor in R1 and the left factor as a temporary storage. In the next level, we'll merge the temporary storage in column-wise and split in row-wise and get this new transformed matrix. And then we'll perform another low rank product, and which is stored as factors in R3 and R2. This is the final form of a three-level butterfly. When we follow the data flow of the algorithm, it really mimics the data flow in FFT. That's why it's called a butterfly. It's also worth mentioning that to form all this low rank product, we don't have to form all the submatrices explicitly, but rather we can take advantage of a small subset of proxy rows, which requires information about the geometry and about the distance information to achieve the quadrilinear complexity. For the second option, we know how to apply the block fast to any vectors. We actually developed this algorithm, which use structured random vectors to retrieve the structure of the desired butterfly. For n by n block A, it actually requires square root n vectors. So that turns out to be n 3/2 log n CPU complexity and other n log n memory complexity algorithm. We also showed that the butterfly compression B of A, the difference between the two is well kept by the level of the butterfly L and the prescribed tolerance epsilon squared. Now we can think of how to construct fast direct solvers using the butterfly algorithm. Essentially, we can just take each of the low rank direct solvers and replace the low rank representation just by the butterflies. For example, this figure shows the low rank H matrix. We just replace the low rank product of the green block into a multi-level butterfly factorization. And following this line of direction, we can upgrade H match into HBF, HDLR into HODBF, HS into HSBF, and there's another open region which is upgrading from H2 to directional H2, which we'll not describe in this talk. So now take a quick look of a few of this format. The first one is HBF. So recall in H matrix, we'll just compress the well separated interaction and their blocks as low rank product. Here we just, for example, the green block is now a three level butterfly. The red block is a two level butterfly, and we keep going like that. And just like the H matrix, we can perform a partition block LU decomposition. And during the decomposition, we perform these so-called butterfly algebras, where we essentially want to compress the result of this compositions of existing butterflies into new butterflies. And that can be accelerated by the randomized butterfly algorithm we mentioned before. And the next one is this HODBF with the extension of the HODLR. So it's more aggressive than the H matrix by compressing more blocks. So essentially all the original blocks here are butterflies of different levels. And during the inversion, we apply these two butterfly operations fast. So particularly the one shown below is the butterfly extension of the Sherry-Morrison-Woodbury formula. We can be even more aggressive by saying, let's make the basis of the butterfly representation of these orange blocks nested with these orange blocks. That ends up into this HSSBF. Where instead of the log n factors in HODBF, and now we have log n factors. So we save an actual log factor. And in the inversion, it's similar to HODBF, so it also requires these two sort of operations. So far, I have revealed six low-rank and butterfly-based Dirac solvers for low-frequency and high-frequency wave equations, particularly Maxwell equations. So let's summarize the complexities here. So for low-rank solvers, low-frequency regime, the matrix construction, factorization, and the solve phase can all scale quasi-linearly. For butterfly-based solvers for high-frequency regimes, again, everything scales quasi-linear except the matrix factorization, which is n 3 half log n, but there are quasi-linear preconditioners out there. We will also show some results later. For all the six Dirac solvers I mentioned, they're all they can all be implemented in a distributed memory fashion. For example, I take two examples, which is HODBF and HSBF. So essentially, this whole structure is parallelized, for example, by 16 processors. And each of the butterflies shown in the, at the orange block here is also a distributed memory parallelization. This is some strong scaling result of both HSSBF and HODBF construction and factor for a 1 million sized problem. And they both scale pretty well, up to 2000 processors. Now let's go through some numerical examples. The first one is using HBF for EFLE to model scattering from conducting objects. The first example is a sphere. So this figure shows as we increase the problem size while fixing the discretization density as a portion, a constant portion of the wavelengths, we observe the predicted scaling. We can also obtain very accurate results compared to analytical solutions. We can also consider more realistic examples. So this is an airplane resulting in a 14 million sized system. We can also obtain a good accuracy compared to fast multiple-based iterative solvers. Then for piecewise constant dielectric objects, we can use the so-called PMCHWT integral equation formulation, which is typically less well-conditioned, but now we can just use the HBF direct solver to obtain very reliable. Instead of scattering problems, we can also consider cavity modelings. Here is an example of the designing accelerator cavities. We will have electron bunches ejected into this beam pot and get accelerated inside, which also generates a higher order resonance mod, which need to be damped by this damping pot. And we can actually use the IE formulation to consider this problem. Suppose this is a cavity with only one pot. We can introduce some magnetic current on the port and then have electric current everywhere on the wall to formulate this Eigen system, Z of F times I equal to zero. We're just looking for the resonance frequency that results into a corresponding system which have close to zero eigenvalues. Apparently, this Z is ill conditioned, and we can naturally consider, for example, the HODLR Dirac solver. And also, instead of the expensive frequency sweeping to identify the resonant frequencies, we can also consider cheap machine learning algorithms to build a surrogate model for each of these resonant modes. So this figure shows the surface electric current and magnetic current at three different frequencies. So in fact, instead of this walking frequency, all the higher order modes need to be damped through these ports. We can also slightly revise this formulation to handle radiation analysis, for example, the characteristic model analysis. So we can just split this Z matrix into real part and imaginary part, then formulate this generalized eigenvalues problem, and we're just looking for eigenvalues close to zero, which represent efficient radiation modes. So this is showing the eigen mode of three frequencies and their far field patterns. Next, we can consider domain decomposition based IE solvers, for example, for modeling manternals. So this is an example of a manternal surrounded by lossy medias. We can formulate the problem using equivalent electric and magnetic current on the surfaces interfaces between the subdomains. The middle shows the coupled domain decomposition system, where the blocks actually scattering matrices that encodes the weaving interactions inside each subdomain. So each of the scattering metrics have factors that can be represented either by HBF or HODBF. This is a numerical example of a MAN gallery. So here we have a point source at the origin, and the lower left figure shows the field everywhere in the MAN gallery. Now for 2D scatterings, we can considering this quasi-linear butterfly preconditioner. For example, this symmetric Gaussi-Seidel type of preconditioner works pretty well for a variety of geometries shown here. We can go up to, for example, 100 million size systems. That's pretty large. And for even for heterogeneous medias, we can also consider so-called volume integral equation formulations, which requires volume metric discretization of the geometry. So here we compare the Laurent-based direct solvers and the butterfly-based direct solvers for dielectric sphere and dielectric L-mount. So the upper is the time, lower is the memory. We can actually see that the butterfly solvers actually have a much smaller leading constant and scales better than the Laurent solvers. Now let's switch our topic to the differential equation solvers. So here, let's again talk about the fast direct solvers for both low frequency and high frequency ranges. We'll also talk about both electromagnetic problems and some acoustic problems. So here, consider this sparse linear system A coming from, for example, FD, finite difference type and element type of discretization of Maxwell or Helmholtz. And we seek for the LU decomposition of A, but we also need to do it the LU on this transform matrix, where this DR, DC, QC are used for improve the numerical stability. And this P is a symmetric permutation operator to reduce the number of fill-ins or number of new non-zeros of the sparse metric when you do the LU factorization. A popular choice is the nested dissection. And depending on the algorithm workflow, there are supernodal-based methods and multifrontal-based methods, but neither of them can attain optimal complexity when you, for example, apply it to a 3D regular grid Helmholtz. with the low rank and butterfly compression based solvers, we will show like for multifrontal solvers, we can attain quasi-linear for both low frequency and high frequency regime. So let's first say a few words about the nested dissection. Consider this 5x5 regular mesh, and we first find this separator that separates the graph into two subgraphs, and then in the two subgraphs we'll find a separator that keep separating them into two graphs. Then by ordering the matrix entries, the matrix rows and columns following this this partitioning, we actually have this this matrix pattern, where we can show that during the LU factorization, the non-zeros, all the fill-ins only appear in these highlighted blocks. So this is a more realistic problem of 15 by 15, 2 degrees, 5-point stencil for Helmholtz. This is the matrix A after the nested detection reordering. This is the LU factors, and the red ones actually are the fill-ins of the new net zeros. And based on the nested detection reordering, the multifrontal algorithm actually treated these densified blocks in a so it will generate this separator tree, and for each node of the tree is a separator, and for each node it's there are so-called frontal matrix associated there, and typically each frontal matrix has a 2x2 partitioning. Let's call the frontal matrix as F tau for node tau. Then F11 of F tau is the interaction. I mean, is the size of the separator itself, and F22 is the interaction between the separator and with its parent separators, and that's so-called the contributing blocks. And performing LU on this matrix sparse pattern results in performing LU in this multifrontal tree or separated tree from bottom to up order. And for example, for each frontal matrix, we typically factorize the F11, then compute the shared complete update, then aggregate it to the parents fronts. And then we can realize that each of the fronts is actually is a summation of the original sparse matrix plus typically two dense children fronts. And we're treating the frontal matrix as dense matrices, and their operations are becoming the CPU and the memory bottleneck of the solver. So now, since the frontal matrix is nothing but the numerical green function between separators, we can apply all the direct order for IE formulations on these frontal matrices. And there are actually quite a few even supernodal and multifrontal solvers with compression enabled. But here we're gonna mainly focus on this HODBF for high frequency Helmholtz and the Maxwell problems. So here I showed the an element mesh and the top three separators. And so for example, then the F11 of this children front is a self-interaction between this green separator, and the red block or the F22, then the contributing block is the part of the interaction between the self-interaction between the red separator. And then these two off-diagonal blocks, the F12 and F21, are the interactions between the two crossing separators. And now we're representing these four blocks either as a butterfly or HODBF format. And then this the LU factorization algebra now becomes we do an inversion or HODBF inversion of the F11, then compute the shared complement update, and then update the F22 again as HODBF, then aggregate to the parent fronts. Now the entire multifrontal solver is also distributed memory parallel. So suppose we have 32 processors to parallelize this frontal solver, multifrontal solver. We actually assign each frontal matrix as a sub MPI processor group, and then we can apply the aforementioned parallelization strategy for HODBF. Now let's go through the these butterfly algebras in more details. Remember we need to construct this F11, F21, F12, and contributing block in a butterfly or HODBF form from element extraction. from sampling the submatrix of these blocks. As we mentioned, that also only requires n log n operand, given the size of these blocks are about n, for example. And that does require that you pre-select some submatrix of this submatrix based on the graph distance that is induced directly by the sparsity, by the sparse matrix itself. And then evaluating the submatrix of this submatrix, that boils down, for example, if you want to evaluate this submatrix of this frontal matrix, that boils down to evaluating from the original sparse matrix and the two children HODBF. Then it further boils down to select the submatrix from a single butterfly. For example, this shows example of selecting a 1x1 submatrix and a 1x2 submatrix from this three-level butterfly. That turns out you need to multiply all these highlighted blocks in a distributed fashion. That's what we have implemented. And once F01 is compressed, now we invert F01 using the HODBF algorithm we just mentioned, or we previously mentioned. And then the short complement, which is F21 times F11 inverse times F12, we compress that thing as a butterfly using the MATLAB based construction algorithm. This is also previously mentioned. So this is a power of performance of the three operations, meaning construction of F11 from element extraction and the construction from the short complement from MATLAB, and the inversion of the F11. So they both seems to scale pretty well. Now, putting everything together, we can see a few things about the complexity of the overall multifrontal solver based on the HODBF. So, and also based on low-rank algorithm, although we don't quite really mention these solvers. So for the low-rank solvers, for 3D problems, if it's low frequency, we can actually attain n complex n for the factorization and for the application or for the solve phase. For high frequency problem, this HODBF based multifrontal solver, we can attain almost everything n, and then something n log n for the factorization. So this is actually the fastest multifrontal solver for high frequency wave equations.
So here is some example. We're solving 3D acoustic propagation in homogeneous media. So the domain is the equation is discretized with 27-point finite difference stencil using a 3D regular grid with 15 points per wavelength. So the left figure shows the factor flops. The middle shows the solve flops. The right shows the factor memory using the exact multifrontal solver and the HODBF multifrontal solver. So for HODBF, we're showing like two slightly different settings, but we're basically observing the n log square n or the n complexity as expected.
And this is for inhomogeneous genus media. So here we imported this MOMOSI 2 p-wave velocity model, and that results in a 21 million sized sparse system. So that's the model itself, and this is the real part of the pressure fields with a source in the center. And finally, this is a finite element formulation for 3D Maxwell. Here it's a first order Nadelic element, and we're keeping 24 points per wavelength. So here is the on the right it's the surface E field, and on the left it's some breakdown of the technical data. So here you can see that the compressed front is only six of roughly almost 4 million of the fronts. Then it turns out the overall compression is not great, but for this six compressed one, it's very good. We're working on, say, combining the HODBF with other low-rank formats for the entire frontal multifrontal solvers. Finally, I will say a few things about software. So almost all the work I've been mentioning, they are available in these two packages, Butterfly Pack and Strong Pack. So as you can see from the table, so Butterfly Pack is a dense solver, and it supports HODBF, HODLR, and HS Butterfly. And Strong Pack is a both dense and sparse solver, and it supports this HSS and block and low rank formats. So Butterfly Pack can be used inside a Strong Pack to support a wide range of all these formats for both dense and sparse linear systems.
Here is some acknowledgement, and I will stop here, and I'm happy to take any question.
Thank you very much, Yang. Very interesting talk, and yeah, you've made fantastic progress, especially on the differential equation front. So it's amazing, right, that you can now have a butterfly-based multifrontal solvers. So that it's just it's beautiful work. Are there any questions from the audience? If you can put them in the chat, that'd be great. I'd be also happy to unmute you if you want to ask a question. Let's see if there's anything in the chat. If not, I can ask some questions, but
okay, go ahead.
Well, I'm still waiting to see if it shows up in the chat here.
Well, maybe the typing, I want to emphasize that most of the solvers I mentioned here not only applies to wave equation, but also apply to more general context, for example, for some. Some mechanical fluid dynamic calculations for some machine learning kernels, those can all exhibit low rank compression properties, and these solvers are pretty general for those purpose too.
So I was going to ask a question along those lines. So if people download your Butterfly Pack, how generic is it? I mean, how much do you have to understand the butterfly theory for these packages to work effectively on one's problem?
So the software has multiple solver options. So it's just a single flag to turn on and off of certain features. So in terms of interface, it's pretty simple. So there's two main interfaces. One is a user only need to know give us a function to evaluate any entry of a matrix. So that's the entry evaluation based construction. The second one is if the user can provide a function or a subroutine and multiply the whole matrix with any vectors fast, then we can also construct the hierarchical matrices. It's also like a pretty, I would say it's pretty like a black box type of interface for general applications.
Any questions? And in terms of the differential equation solvers, how, so on paper, asymptotically, you beat the state of the art, right? In practice, how did these things work out? Are the leading constants at this point small enough?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good catch. Because what I showed here is, I mean, in terms of memory, you can see it's dramatic reduction. And these two are actually the flop, in terms of the flops. But in terms of this actual CPU time, the crossover point is pretty high. At this point, without any fine tuning or code optimization, at this point, it's around, for example, for this example, 220 cubed. So it's only after this point, it will be faster than the exact solver. So for this regular problem, it's pretty useful already. But for this finite element example, we actually haven't seen much improvement in terms of overall timing compared with exact solvers. That's why we think like it probably makes more sense to just do the butterfly compression for the top level frontal matrices, but in the middle ones, although they're also compressible, maybe Butterfly will give a much leading constant. There we can consider other low rank algorithms instead.
And how for differential equation solvers, the effectiveness of the Butterfly scale, if you wish, with the order of the solver. So suppose one uses these very high order discontinuous Galerkin type methods. Do you have to hybridize them with other techniques, or does the scheme apply wholesale right out of the box?
We haven't really tried high order meshes, but the example I showed here is from the taken from the metrics from the MFEM software, which actually supports a variety of discretization elements and basis function orders. But from the preliminary results we have done here, it's apparent that we have to use very high accuracy in Butterfly, because the problem is highly indefinite, and at the end of the sparse system is super ill conditioned, and I don't have any affirmative conclusion about the high orders, but for these low orders, you have to do a very, very accurate compression.
So there is a question in the chat from Professor Tsang. So he asked whether you can give a physical interpretation of the constant rank of the butterfly. So yeah, that's really the core principle of the butterfly. Give it a shot.
Yeah, we can. This is what actually Eric showed me long time ago. For the many summers we have discussed this may not apply to each of them, but for example, for the H matrix, HBF matrix, this is what's happening under the hood. So in HBF matrix, you're considering the blocks, off diagonal blocks that represent interactions between these well separated geometry pairs. And long time ago, Eric and many others actually showed that the rank, interaction rank of the corresponding block, it's actually in 2D, it's actually bounded by this formula. So K is the wave number, AS and AO are actually the radius of the observer and the source, D is the distance between the two. In the typical discretization, if you consider the rank of the entire block, that apparently that will increase as k. So in Butterfly, we don't consider the entire pairwise interaction, but rather we consider interaction between the sub pairs. For example, we can pick the south junction to be small enough such that its size is proportional to 1/1 the wave number. Then if you plug in this, AS and the K will cancel out the K. So the rest we can treat it as a constant. Then the next level, we can just do the splitting of the observer and do the merge of the cells, which means there's a reduction in AO and a doubling in AS, which cancels out each other. At the end, this also will keep as a constant.
So I think in a nutshell, if you take a scatterer, a radiator, the degrees of freedom of the radiator, or the field of the radiator, increase with the size of the radiator measured in wavelengths. But if you, while increasing the size of the radiator, in the example that Yang gives here, the size of the source region, if at the same time you shrink proportionally the size of the observer region, then the number, and if you ensure that in doing so, the number of waves that you observe in the source region, in the observer region, remains constant, and of course the rank of interaction remains constant. It's all very much related to optical aperture and things like that.
Yeah, so this kind of explanation really applies to this so-called strong admissibility based representations. So for many other solvers we have described, we actually will compress more than this. So we compress even interaction between like a touching or adjacent pairs. So there, the argument will be more subtle than this, but roughly speaking, like when the geometries are far away, you can still apply this argument, but when they're close by, they're actually either collinear or coplanar. So actually their solid angle to each other is also pretty small. So that's why you can have a good compression.
So perhaps in the context of rough surface scattering, of course, it's something that very much interests Professor Tsang, because there most source and observers are quasi coplanar. things like this have a kind of an inherent advantage over fast multiple methods, which work on plane wave deconditioning and where you have to kind of jump through hoops in order to exploit the quasi planarity of a structure. Sorry, I'm getting excited here myself, right? So, but it's other questions. No? Well, if not, then wanna thank Yang for coming home, right?
And thank you for the invitation. Yeah.
Giving a talk here.
Nice to meet the friends. Yeah.
it's always great to see people being so successful and then come home and talk about it. So thank you very much, Yang. I appreciate it. Not sure if we thank can applaud, but I'm gonna.
Thank you. I heard it. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. Bye, everyone. And bye-bye. Thanks for attending.